Welcome to the D Tycoon Community Community Unity Now. I want to introduce Julia Gerasimenko. And how are you doing?
I'm doing well, thanks.
You're with the Active Transportation Alliance.
That's right.
Tell me about it.
Sure. So, yeah, I'm the advocacy manager at the Active Transportation Alliance. So we're a non-for-profit advocacy organization working to promote walking, biking, and public transportation. And we believe when we design our world to promote those modes of getting around, we'll create healthier, more sustainable, and more equitable communities.
Okay, so walking. Tell me about pedestrians.
Oh, I mean, absolutely. It's the best way to get around, right? Mm-hmm. And we say that everybody starts and ends their trip as a pedestrian, right? Whether you're walking to the bus stop or the train, whether you're parking and walking from your car, whether you're parking your bike and walking, right? Mm-hmm. So we think that there's no better way to get around than walking, yeah.
That's great. And bicycling?
And absolutely, yes. So another really active, healthy mode, way to get around. It's also very low cost. Right? Mm-hmm. So it's an affordable, easy way to get from point A to point B, and is also very joyful. I think people forget about just how much fun it is to get on a bike.
And what was the third one again?
And public transportation.
Public transportation. That's my favorite.
Yes, great. Okay. So I personally am a huge fan of our bus network in Chicago, but we're really lucky to have CTA, Pace, and Metra in our region. And yeah, so it's... public transit is the most sustainable way to get around. We know that if everybody was driving their own single occupancy vehicle, that we simply would not have enough space on the streets, right? Mm-hmm. So we want to encourage people to get out of their cars and taking these other modes, because we believe they're the safest way to get around as well, right? When people are driving, operating these multi-ton vehicles, there's many crashes that happen with serious injuries and fatalities. And so every day when we go to work, we work to shift people out of cars and onto these other modes that are safer, healthier for the environment, that also allow for less congestion on our streets.
That's great, because we have a real issue with congestion, especially on Devon Avenue. My friend was killed
on Devon Avenue. Oh, I'm so sorry to hear that.
By a hit-and-run driver.
When was that?
That was many years ago.
Okay.
But it was still horrible to this day.
Absolutely, yes.
And also around Loyola Avenue. Loyola and Sheridan Broadway intersection. Mm-hmm. We always advocate for public safety because every now and again, Loyola students, they think the whole world is their campus over there.
Right.
They think they're at home.
Sure.
And, you know, they get hit by cars around that curve sometimes.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of things happen with that, and then there's a lot of accidents as well.
Right, and so the city of Chicago has what's called a Vision Zero plan. Mm-hmm. So what that means is they're trying to reduce all traffic crashes and serious injuries and fatalities to zero. And so we believe that design of our streets is the best way to get there. So when we design our streets to make it the easiest, fastest, safe option, if every Chicagoan could walk out their door and have a protected bike lane or have a bus stop right out their door, we would reduce crashes. When we design our streets that are more narrow, that help people slow down, we're also making our streets safer. So it's about reducing speed limits. When cars hit a person going at 20 miles per hour, they're 90% likely to walk away fine. It exponentially decreases as you go up in speed. So a person who's hit with a car going 30 miles per hour versus 40 miles per hour, you're seeing less and less of a chance that that person's going to walk away unscathed, and likely will result in a fatality anywhere upwards of 30 miles per hour.
Okay, so how are you different from the Chicago Department of Traffic? It seems like they're trying to speed things up. They're trying to shorten the lights. I don't know if they're in charge of the red light cameras or not, but tell me about that.
Sure. So we're separate from the city government. So we're an advocacy group. So we try to work with city agencies and bring community voices to the forefront. And so they're our partner. They're sometimes our target, you know. So we advocate with them. Yeah.
So you're a nonprofit organization.
That's correct.
Are you a 501c3?
Yes, we are. And actually, last year around the time of the state and city elections, we created a 501c4, which allowed us to do some electioneering work
some
as well.
Politics.
Yes.
Wow, that's interesting. So you got to keep the C3 apart from the C4
at
all times.
Absolutely.
It's called the Chinese wall. You put that in between there.
Yes.
So how do you do that?
Sure, yeah. So we have different staff that mm-hmm. works on the C4 work, and we make sure that we separate it in terms of, you know, every single day. Like my work, it's more on the community side of things. Mm-hmm. But we mostly separate it on based on staff.
Is it like the same office space?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Same office space is okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Same time spent. You can't do the same projects at the same workspace.
No. But I'm no expert on it, so I don't want to speak too much to that mm-hmm. since my work primarily falls with the C3. So.
Because that's really interesting, because an organization that works in our neighborhood, mm-hmm. J&M Senior Caucus.
Oh, sure.
I was working with them when they were only a nonprofit organization. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Then they wanted to get involved in politics, mm-hmm. and they created a C4. Mm-hmm. And they had to put up the Chinese wall and all this other things mm-hmm. going on. Mm-hmm. But there were some shared things, and mm-hmm. there were some things that had to be completely separate.
Yes, that's right. Yeah, so for example, last year with the mayoral election, we held a bus riders forum in Pilsen at the Pilsen Public Library. Mm-hmm. And that work was very much done totally under the C4, so that we were able to, you know, invite the candidates there and ask kind of targeted questions, and then give some commentary on which responses we appreciated, which we didn't so much, and so yeah.
Mm-hmm. So do people who hold elected public offices support you?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, we have a lot of great champions at every level of government. Mm-hmm. Couldn't do this work without them, right? So much of the decision-making when it comes to transportation infrastructure falls mm-hmm. to elected officials. And so we really look to partner with them, and, you know, We also think, like, you know, everyone's a transportation expert, right? Everybody's trying to get from point A to point B every single day, including our elected officials, right? So we definitely look to partner with them and try to invite them to, you know, bike rides, to bus ride-alongs, to, mm-hmm. You know, all sorts of events, and engage them wherever we can.
So you took the pink line.
Yes.
I took the red line.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And so how would you... How do you work with the Chicago Transit Authority, and what kind of improvements were you a part of mm-hmm. as far as the trains and the buses?
Sure, absolutely. So I've been with the Active Transportation Alliance for 2.5 years now, and in my time, our transit advocacy has been primarily focused on bus service in Chicago. Mm-hmm. So Chicago's actually facing a bus ridership crisis. We've lost 21% of rides since 2012. So even though every single day more bus trips are taken in Chicago than train trips, mm-hmm. we're still seeing dropping numbers in terms of bus ridership. So what we've focused on is trying to improve bus speed and reliability. Mm-hmm. If a bus trip was as fast and reliable as a car trip, people would be choosing the bus, right? Because then you can read, you can talk to people. It's a much more relaxing experience than mm-hmm. being stuck in traffic. So we want to see the city of Chicago prioritize street space for buses. So the work I've been involved in has primarily focused on our bus advocacy through our Bus Friendly Streets report cards. So if you were to go to activetrans.org/bus-report-cards, you can actually see we gave grades to bus service broken down by ward in the city of Chicago and mm-hmm. for the 8 highest ridership routes. So all of that data is based on the speed and reliability of buses, because mm-hmm. when we went out and surveyed bus riders, those were the two factors that mattered most to them.
Great. So do you work with PACE at all? Are you in the suburbs as well as the city?
So we're a regional organization, yes. Mm-hmm. My colleague Maggie, her work focuses in the suburbs, but mm-hmm. I'm primarily in the city. But we recently also worked on a Fair Fares Chicagoland campaign and put out a report talking about how to make the fare system, the mm-hmm. regional transit fare system, more equitable. Mm-hmm. So we're calling for a 50% reduced fare for anyone living in the RTA, the Regional Transit Authority mm-hmm. service area. So that would be on Metra, PACE, and CTA mm-hmm. For lower income folks who are struggling to even afford, you know, the PACE, a ride on PACE. So we think that could get in the region more people taking PACE and Metra as well. And we surveyed close to 700 low income residents of the area, and they all said they would be taking transit more. They would be more likely to get to doctor's appointments, to job interviews, if they were able to have access to this discount. So that's one example of how we're working regionally.
Okay, and something that happened today.
Yeah.
Roosevelt Station. Mm-hmm. I was coming up the Roosevelt Station, mm-hmm. and the escalator was broken, mm-hmm. and they had the police upstairs, mm-hmm. and they had CTA personnel on the bottom and mm-hmm. on the top, mm-hmm. and they made it to a single file line, and mm-hmm. it was totally packed. We were cattle in there. Uh-huh. Once we get over towards, past downtown, mm-hmm. heading towards Roosevelt, it's mm-hmm. like cattle. It's mm-hmm. always like cattle. Mm-hmm. So, where do you step in situations like that with escalators and mm-hmm. actual train stations?
Yeah, so that's an interesting question. We have done some transit station audits in the past, so making sure that the space itself is accessible for all people. Mm-hmm. Right now, CTA also has, or recently, CTA put out an ASAP plan, so a station accessibility plan, making sure that stations have escalators and elevators for people of all abilities to be able to access those transit stops. And while we have more accessible stations than say New York City, we still have a long way to go. Mm-hmm. So CTA is committed to making every single station accessible by, I believe, 2030.
It should have been 1995.
I agree.
It should have been 1995.
Yeah.
And when they redid that Jarvis station, and when they redid that Moore station a couple mm-hmm. years ago, mm-hmm. they should have put elevators mm-hmm. because mm-hmm. we've got seniors. And we've got people with disabilities that need to get around as well. And yeah. and I in the Belmont station, the Belmont Blue Line station, mm-hmm. they made this beautiful butterfly blue glowing LED. Mm-hmm. And Ariel Rebois was there with mm-hmm. Rahm Emanuel, mm-hmm. cutting the ribbon. Mm-hmm. Not ADA accessible.
Yeah. So
no.
It's definitely also a challenge with funding, but we're glad that they at least have this plan, and then it's our jobs as advocates and partnership with mm-hmm. other organizations such as Access Living. Metropolitan Planning Council also just put out a mm-hmm. fantastic report just this week called Universal Mobility that also speaks to transit accessibility for all. So so we would work in partnership to hold CTA accountable to that plan they've put forth.
So how accountable is CTA for ADA accessibility, because obviously it's not there. So mm-hmm. what do they have to provide to the people with disabilities in the city of Chicago?
Again, this isn't my area of expertise, so I'm mm-hmm. not entirely sure. You know, there is the American with Disabilities Act, which is chiefly the biggest piece of legislation we have on books at the federal level that makes it such that they have to make new projects accessible as they're mm-hmm. constructing them. I believe with the Belmont station, it was because it would have been like a retrofitting. It wasn't mm-hmm. a brand new station. That's why it didn't trigger that ADA right. Compliance. So so I believe when they're creating a totally new station, that's when they would have mm-hmm. to make sure. Yeah.
Well, it's time to rebuild all those stations new if that's what it's going to take to make them ADA accessible.
Absolutely.
And accessible to everybody, mm-hmm. not just a few. Mm-hmm. What do you think about transit-oriented development?
Oh, well, we think it's a fantastic idea. In fact, I personally just testified recently at the Zoning Committee of City Council to get a space in Logan Square by the Logan Square Blue Line mm-hmm. rezoned to become a 100% affordable housing development. Mm-hmm. So it's well on its way. I believe it just has one more hurdle to jump through. Mm-hmm. But what we think about transit-oriented development is that it needs to be equitable. And what do I mean by that? It shouldn't just be for it shouldn't just be studios and one bedrooms really high prices of this new kind of mm-hmm. Exciting thing of like, oh, I just want to live by the train, right? It's becoming kind of this cool, hot thing. But we need to make sure that transit-oriented development is affordable for low-income families and built for families. So this Emmett Street project, I'd encourage everybody at home to check out the hashtag Bring Emmett Home, mm-hmm. Is a fantastic example of how the city of Chicago can be moving towards more equitable transit-oriented development.
Okay, because I see developers mm-hmm. taking advantage of that, mm-hmm. of course, mm-hmm. But there's still cars mm-hmm. on the street.
Yeah.
They can't hold the mm-hmm. their renters or condo purchasers accountable for... They can't have them sign a contract saying they're not going to have a car.
Right, of course not.
That's a big loophole.
Right, but, for the amount of parking space and just literal space that parking takes up, mm-hmm. we're excited that transit-oriented development just decreases that footprint and allows more space for, say, public green space or bike lanes or whatever mm-hmm. else there can be, yeah.
Okay, mm-hmm. so where did you receive your initial funding?
As an organization?
Yes.
So we're a not-for-profit, so our kind of flagship fundraiser event is Bike the Drive. So every year, the weekend of Memorial Day, we shut down Lakeshore Drive for a few hours in the morning, and people pay to participate. So that raises a great deal of funds for us, and is also just like a fantastic, joyful event that allows people to experience, wow, this is what it could be like without the noise and the congestion and the pollution of cars, and it's just it's a great day. Yeah.
Cool. Cool. So your website states that 24% of jobs are accessible in the city and 12% in the suburbs. What work has the Active Transportation Alliance done to improve these percentages, and how have these percentages changed?
Yeah, so I believe that's like accessible by transit, right? So in terms of those percentages, you know, they're awfully low, and we'd like to see them grow, and they really haven't. And so that's where we need to be also working with businesses and companies to make sure that they are actually choosing to be located by transit as well, right? So you've seen this return of corporations coming back to city centers because they know that's how they can attract top talent as well. But I think it speaks to like this spatial mismatch of where jobs are and where people are living and where people can afford to be living. And so what our Fair Fare Chicagoland research showed too when we were interviewing low-income folks in the region was that 60% of people said they would be more likely to look for a job further away if they had access to this discounted fare. So it's a very complex issue, but it requires a lot of buy-in from both businesses as well as elected officials who would want to encourage this type of growth and development and job production.
Way back in the day, when we had our chamber office on Sheridan Road, we were approached by the CTA about their upcoming Red and Purple Line modernization project. Multi-million-dollar? Billion-dollar?
It might be billion. Yeah, I'm not actually sure. Yeah.
So tell us a little bit about that and how you're working with that.
Yeah, so I mean, that's a very, as you said yourself, a very extensive project, very bold and ambitious. And, you know, so part of what we're excited about is creating faster, more reliable train service. So having people see the red and purple lines as, you know, the best way to get from their community to wherever else they need to go. So that investment will make sure that trains aren't getting delayed, which happened to me on the way here on the Pink Line, they're moving as quickly and as efficiently as possible. And that also included some study on transit-oriented development as well. So a lot of the communities along the Red Line are quite dense. So how can we be encouraging more transit-oriented development along the Red and Purple Lines? So we're really excited about it. Of course, we always want to see equitable investment across our city. So hopeful that the Red Line extension can also come to fruition one day. That's also been, you know, decades in the making and still isn't a reality yet. But CTA says it's well on the way.
So for our audience, how far was it supposed to go?
The Red Line extension?
Yeah,
so down to 130th Street. So a lot of people don't know that Chicago extends well beyond even 95th Street.
To the southeast side too?
Yep. So we still want to bring attention to that project, and hopefully that can come to be as well.
So some things about the Red Line, Purple Line modernization project. Eminent Domain. They're going to have to tear down some houses possibly for this one. And then they have the flyover that goes around. Tell us about the flyover. We can talk about Eminent Domain all night, I bet.
Sure.
But the flyover.
Sure, yeah. So, you know, there's been, with the Brown Line, Purple and Red Lines all converging at the Belmont Station, there can be quite a bit of backlog sometimes. So this flyover allows for the Brown Line to be able to pass through more easily and create a smoother, faster service for everyone along those three lines. So we're excited about it. Yeah.
Okay. And then one of the things, I guess maybe one of the things that I can agree that ROM did was putting a Wi-Fi, free Wi-Fi, in the subway system. It's on some stations, not all stations. I don't know if you even know, but they put it in the stations, not on the trains. So it cuts off, and when it stops, you get to use it. Mm-hmm. And then it goes, and then you don't get to use it. You get a good 3-5 seconds mm-hmm. with the Wi-Fi. Mm-hmm. So I'm guessing you're in favor for the Wi-Fi.
You know, we haven't really taken a stance on it as an organization. Mm-hmm. We focus, again, on kind of the speed and reliability of service. That's primarily our concern, and would hope that, you know, that kind of more low-hanging fruit would be prioritized. But if Wi-Fi is going to get more people to ride transit, hey, we're all for it.
It sure will. When I have a choice, when I'm at mm-hmm. Jefferson Station mm-hmm. and I'm visiting my dad and mm-hmm. the little dog Mojito, mm-hmm. hey, Joe, he's watching. Hey, Joe. When I'm over there, uh-huh. where they're watching right mm-hmm. there, mm-hmm. And I'm going over there, I have a choice mm-hmm. at Jefferson Station. Mm-hmm. I could take the blue line to Harlem mm-hmm. and take a walk mm-hmm. if I miss the 68, mm-hmm. or I could take that 68, mm-hmm. which I think is one of the worst lines around.
Okay.
Or I can take the Pace Purple bus, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. and that Pace Purple bus has got Wi-Fi. Mm-hmm. It's got USB chargers
wow,
in there.
Wow.
It's got nice soft seats.
Wow, nice.
It's coming once every 20 minutes, mm-hmm. and it'll take me right over to Milwaukee and Damon.
Mm-hmm.
Quick time.
Mm-hmm.
So do you work with Pace? And how much do you work with Pace, maybe percentage-wise, with the CTA Metro?
You know, I feel like because my role is primarily focused on the city, I tend to work more with CTA, but Pace also operates in parts of the city as well, right?
Mm-hmm.
So really what we would love to see is that all the three agencies working together in collaboration. But I'd say, you know, primarily I think my role focuses more on CTA, but we work with all three agencies in concert. Yeah.
Because I think that if you had Wi-Fi and comfortable seats mm-hmm. and charging ports mm-hmm. and CTA mm-hmm. and in trains, mm-hmm. in buses, that would increase the ridership.
That would
make people believe in your cause.
Mm-hmm.
CTA,
mm-hmm.
get with it. Get with it. That's your clue.
Yes.
I know you're watching. That's your clue. All right. So we were talking about initial funding. Mm-hmm. What is your major current source of funding?
Mm-hmm.
How do you keep the doors open?
Yeah, absolutely. So like I said, Bike the Drive is our largest fundraiser of the year.
Mm-hmm.
We also get grants from different foundations. And then we're also a member-based organization. So for everybody watching tonight, if you're interested in becoming a supporter and you believe in the ability of walking, biking, and transit to transform our communities, please become a member. ActiveTrans.org/membership. It's $35 for an individual membership. You get discounts at bike shops. You get access to prepaid access to our events, and so it's a great way to support our work, our mission, and our advocacy. So, mm-hmm. so membership is another way we keep our doors open. So thank you
so much, Julia.
Thank you.
We only have a little bit of time left,
sure.
And we hit this one on the head, but with this Jarvis and Morse, I want to play this. I have to play this. Mm-hmm. This is last night. At the Pride Workforce Development Resources. All right, very good.
Thank you. Is this at the Soldier Library?
Yeah, it is. Do we got volume?
Oh, there you are.
Hello, everyone. My name is Bill Morton. I'm president of the Rogers Park Chamber of Commerce.
It's at this one. 3 minutes.
Okay.
Residents, businesses, nonprofit organizations, and institutions of the park. We celebrate our diversity because we are the most diverse community in our city of Chicago, if not the entire United States.
Okay, we're going back to you, Cam. Thank you very much, and this is the D Tycoon Show. D Tycoon, thank you. We got to get out of here. I'm over my time. So, good night.
Good night.